Jesus at the center of it all.
Can you hear me? I'll speak English. I'm very grateful to God that I actually is that I have this opportunity to be in your midst. This is truly a divine appointment. I didn't plan this. I didn't even know about this church until maybe late in the morning today. I remember, I always believe, I love architecture. I love architecture with a passion. I love art and architecture. I love food. I like anything that has to do with lifestyle. But the most important thing is, those are side things for me. The most important thing is, we are serving a risen God. And so therefore, what I often ask myself is, what do you want me to do, Lord? He's convicted me about 4 years ago. Lyndon, you've traveled globally. You've gone to different places, sometimes on business class, sometimes on first class. You think it's the client that's paying for all those trips for you. It is me that is sending you out to the different parts of the world, to the ends of the world, using architecture as an excuse for you to share my word. So when I came to Malaysia, I'm giving a talk tomorrow at the Malaysian Architect of Institute. I was told there's going to be about 1,500 people who's going to attend that seminar or that lecture tomorrow. But for some strange reason, my assistant made a mistake and arranged for me to arrive earlier to meet another potential client, which was yesterday, Tuesday. So it bothered me because we've set this appointment. I could not really move it to Thursday morning. So my first prayer was, Lord, what do you want me to do in Kuala Lumpur? I'm flying all the way, 5.5 hours from Shanghai, going to Kuala Lumpur. What do you want me to do? I have a meeting Tuesday. I am free Wednesday. As I was praying this was last week, I said, Lord, you've got to help me on this. This is your business. I got an email from Ian. I didn't even know he was a Christian. He wrote me at that time. I just met him. I just met him in Milan. We briefly met for maybe 5 minutes the most. So there was no way. I didn't even know his background. I didn't know whether he actually speaks Chinese, speaks English. We said hello, so I think he spoke English. He actually called my name, and I was kind of surprised. I said, where are you guys from, Malaysia? And I said, you know, I actually have a project there, so I will go. And it's strange, because when I made that prayer last week, his email came in. And he said, weren't you planning to come to Malaysia? And out of habit, I said, sure, it'll be good. We should meet. And he proceeded to arrange meetings for me to have me interviewed all day today. And it was through the interviewing process, when people were asking me about different people, my life's conviction and all that stuff. I talk about architecture passionately. But of course, when I talk about God, it comes to life. And this was when Ian was there listening to me and said, oh, so you're a Christian. And we had this amazing discussion and discourse. And I said, do you have a service? And he says, actually, tonight, the one night that I'm free in Kuala Lumpur, there is a service here. God is good. God is amazing. I'm still in awe of how good He is. But let me start by reading a passage to you, which I'm going to share. It's in the book of Joshua, chapter 24. I'm a younger generation, so I'm going to use my iPad Bible, okay? I'm not that young. So Joshua chapter 24, verse 13 to 15. So I gave you a land on which you did not toil, and cities you did not build. And you live in them and eat from vineyards and olive groves that you did not plant. Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods your ancestors worshipped beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Amorite in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. You have to remember in verse 13, it clearly tells you the cities you did not build, the land, the vineyards you did not possess were given to you. They were gifts from God. It's not our own doing, guys. It's not our own doing. They were blessed. We were blessed to be given all these. And for a minute, if we think it's our own effort, our own labor, or if we think for a moment there are other people, our clients perhaps, the wealthy billionaires that's helping us build our business, you guys are wrong. You have to remember that it is from Him. It is our choice, however, whether we actually want to believe in ourselves, believe in other gods, or are we going to be like Joshua and say, as for me and my family, we will serve the Lord. Let me just tell you three stories that relates to my testimony. When I was young, when I was in my 20s, I just had finished architecture school, my graduate program at Harvard. And I remember it was in the 90s. Don't do your math right now. You'll know how old I am. And I remember the job market in New York was extremely dire, especially for architecture. Real estate at that time had just plummeted, early 90s. I won't tell you how early. I had just graduated. I got a job. I started working for this practice. 6 months after I worked, the boss came to me and says, Lyndon, you're doing a good job. When your boss tells you you're doing a good job in America, two things happen. You either get promoted or you get laid off, not fired. There's a difference between getting fired and laid off. Laid off is basically saying, we love you, but there is no work. We've got to let you go. Well, he proceeded to tell me this on a Monday, and he let me go. He says, by the end of the week, I'm so sorry, Lyndon, but two of the projects that you're working on just died. I remember I just got married. Didn't have kids then. I was in my 20s. I just finished graduate program. I had this very simple prayer. Lord, do not let a day go by without me not having work. That was Monday. All the way to Friday. As an architect, you work long hours. So been working long hours. Didn't even get a chance to send my resumes to other practices. And I remember coming Friday, I didn't tell my wife, who just committed his life to this man. Well, that's the near and who, the who component, yeah? And I still remember to myself to this day, how am I going to tell her that I've just lost my job? But I said, Lord, this is a simple prayer, and I know you're going to answer. It's already given to you. I'm not going to even worry about it, okay? But we're human beings. We worry. Do not let a day go by without me not have any work. Friday came. The morning was busy. Around 1 o'clock, my boss said, Lyndon, do me a favor. Our modeling room need all the supplies. Go to this store and get some supplies. And I was really depressed. Yeah, it was 2 o'clock, Friday, didn't know what to do, no job. I didn't even send resumes out. There was no way I would be able to find a job. So I went out, went to a small store. The store is about as big as this stage. And all they sold was a little piece of wood. This is in business world, it's called just stupid. There's no way they could make money out of a small store like this, selling little wood and little glue. And the place was completely empty. It was by myself, and I was kind of depressed, dejected, down. And I said to myself, wow, how am I going to get a job? I remember going up to the cashier station, and they had those old classic thing that goes this way, you know, to check the machine. It was not computerized. There was this old Indian lady, 70-year-old approximately, and there was this Bible verse. 1 Thessalonians chapter 9, 15, 16. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, In everything, give thanks, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. I looked up. I said, I thought she's Hindu. I thought she's... So I said, lady, are you a Christian? She says, little boy, this is what I remember. Little boy, let me tell you one thing. I have followed this God for 40-odd years. I don't promise you it will always be high. There will always be up and down. But he's real and he's sovereign and he's alive today. God spoke to me that day, I remember. I look at that Bible verse. I went out. I looked back at the store. It was decrepit at best. The supplies were limited. I don't even know how they make money. But there's this woman, elderly woman, praising God despite of this condition. It was raining very hard, and the Lord spoke to me in a very clear way. Here you are, a Harvard graduate. I've blessed you with many things. And listen to that old lady with this store still praising my name after all these years. I left that place. It was raining. It was pouring. But I knew that the prayer I did that Monday, and with this Bible verse, that God was going to answer my prayer. I walked into the office, and my boss goes, Lyndon, someone just called. Someone needed an architect immediately with 15 years of experience. I said, great, God, I only have 2 years of experience. 15, are you teasing me? So I went for this interview anyways at 5 o'clock that afternoon. And the person goes, well, your boss said he was going to send someone, but I wanted someone with 15 years of experience. What are you doing here? 2 years of experience. I said, I know, but can you just look at my portfolio? He did. And he says, it's interesting. Looking at your portfolio now, I realize maybe we have an opening for you. Can you start tomorrow, Saturday? Not a day went by. I said, okay, Lord, you're real. How about Monday? Let's not do that. Let me take the weekend off. God is real, guys. Those were days in my 20s when I was young. God continued to be real in my life. I'm not going to tell you a lot of my stories. I'm going to tell you a number of stories. If you put God ahead of everything as your main focus and your mission work, if God is truly and his kingdom is truly your mission field and your mission work, he will take care of it. I remember in Paris, I was flying in for a project for a client from Zhengzhou. If you don't know Zhengzhou, it's in the middle of China, Henan, a very wealthy Chinese client. And they have a soccer team. So they go to Paris to go to the flea market to buy stuff for their hotel we're designing. At the same time, they're also recruiting soccer stars for their team, okay, in Henan. I've gone to these trips many times, and I get really bored. And I said to myself, oh, another one of these trips with very wealthy people, traveling around the world. I'm tired. Lord, I just want to design. The Lord goes, give me a try, Lyndon. I'm also in Paris, do you know? And so here I am. I'm saying, okay, fine. We landed on a Thursday evening. And this wealthy client of mine goes, Lyndon, I need for you to meet all my soccer players. I need for you to meet all my wealthy friends in Paris. And I'm like, last thing I want is to be meeting wealthy people. I'm not interested in meeting wealthy individuals. But my wife says, you know, Lyndon, look, he's our client. Just do the protocol, okay? And be a Chinese sometimes and 客气一点. So I said, okay, we'll do that. I was bored during dinner all along. I'm sitting there. And all of a sudden, my client turned to one of his best friends, who's one of the most successful jewelry person in Paris, and say, Vasco, let me ask you a question. Why is your marriage lasted this long? And he says, do you really want to know my secret? My client goes, yes, I do. Can you please share it with everyone? And he says, if it's just up to me, it won't work. It's the God I believed in. I was shocked. Vasco, if you know Paris, Vasco is the biggest jewelry, probably the most important. And here is this Armenian Parisian guy praising God in front of all the soccer stars and all the wealthy individuals in Paris. I turned to Vasco immediately, my light. I was so tired, jet lagged. But when he said that, I said, Vasco, He's like, I will tell you this story on one condition. This is what Vasco says. You allow me to say grace for dinner. And he did. When he said grace, I turned to Vasco. I said, Vasco, this is amazing. We had an amazing conversation. And all of a sudden, I said, do you have a service here in Paris? Just like I asked Ian today. And funny enough, he says, that's interesting. We have a service tomorrow. Now, my client flew me from Shanghai to Paris, paid my business class ticket, which I believe is $6,000, including my wife's, to total $12,000 for me to go to Paris and not do the project and go to church. Something's very wrong, right? Well, I said, Lord, I need to go to the service. I need to, you know, come and worship you. And the Lord impressed upon my heart, just ask. So I went to my client. I was like, why don't we meet in the morning? In the afternoon, can I go to service with your friend? And both him and her, husband and wife, were so happy that I got along with this Parisian friend of theirs that they said, go ahead. Go do that. As we went to this service, it was all in French, so I didn't understand a thing. But the presence of the Lord was in that place. I've been to Paris many times, brothers and sisters. I love caviar, I love Givenchy, I love Christian Dior, I love all the brands. But this was one of the most amazing experiences, to feel the presence of the Lord in a cultural city that I thought already had denied God. And in that means was a group of French-speaking people praising this almighty sovereign God. I turned to my wife, who was crying in tears. And she turned to me and she goes, you don't have to say anything, Lyndon. I understand. This is one of the biggest gifts that God has given us. Seek ye first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Restaurants, Michelin star restaurants, good shopping, all that are great. But I'll tell you, this was a more amazing experience. But what's next? The next morning, we had to go to the flea market. The first thing this client came up and goes, how was church yesterday? Perfect opening for me to that from Paris to the antique market took an hour and a half. An hour and a half for me nonstop to tell her how great my God was. This couple paid $12,000, let me remind you, $12,000 for us to play business class so that we can tell them about the God we know. And our God is an amazing God because God loves them before they even know it. And it was an amazing experience. But I want to make sure that we remember, we constantly have to remind ourselves that this land has been given to us. The vineyards, the grapes, you know, all the fertilizers have been taken care of. God has been taking care. So we have to always remember, as for me and my family, we will serve the Lord. I also believed in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9. It says, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived the things that God has prepared for those who love him. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived the things that God has prepared for those who loved him. I'm going to close with one last testimony because I want people to have opportunities. I shared this with Ian today. It was actually in one of the interview, and the person who interviewed me might actually be kind of shocked because I went off tangent and start talking about God instead of architecture. But I'm very passionate when I talk about architecture. But when we talk about God, I cannot deny the fact that as much as I love architecture, he's just a lot more awesome than every building that I could ever experience and build. About 3 years ago, we were shortlisted an international competition. We were the only Chinese firm. In that mix were some of my Harvard professors. 16 firms were shortlisted for a major competition in Covent Garden. A lot of you probably know England. Across from the Opera House is one of the oldest courthouse in the world. It was built in the 1600. And the competition called for a hotel and a museum. 16 firms were shortlisted. my managing director, when they saw the list and saw all the firms that were listed, if you're an architect, you will know if I rattle all the names, you'll probably say, Lyndon, just step aside. Be happy that you're selected as one of the 16. There's absolutely no way you stand a chance. 16 firms. I said, why don't we give it a shot? So 16 firms went to 6. By the time it got to 6, my managing director came to us again and says, okay, Lyndon, are you now happy? Is your ego completely stroked? Your final 6, let's just bail out and say, thank you, we're too busy. And at least in our resume, we said final 6 for the major convent garden transformation. I prayed about it. I said, Jerry, God is asking me to continue. And this is what I do in the office. So we did that. And Jerry, who's born a Catholic, say he's a Catholic, does not really practice going to church or even says to me, well, Lyndon, this is business, you know. We can't really include God in this process. I said, I understand, but, you know, he is my boss. So we went from 6 down to 2. We were still in there. During that final presentation, that morning, I was reading God's word. And in Jeremiah 29, 11 to 13, the word came to me. It says, my plans for you is to prosper you, to give you a hope and a future, and not to destroy you, so that you will seek me and pray to me. If you pray to me with all your heart, I will be found by you. You know, I was born in a church called the Brethren. I think maybe in Chinese it's called, in Hokkien it's called Zuhuiso, you know. So the interpretation immediately when I read that, I'm like, okay, Lord, I'm not going to win this, you know. It's to prosper me, to give me a hope. Prospering doesn't mean that I'm going to get a project. Prospering is that I will be closer to you. That means I'm going to be distracted with this project. I find many excuses to get out of the fact that I might lose, okay. But that breakfast morning, for some strange reason, I have an atheist next to me, 2 atheists. Some of my top associates do not even believe that there is a God. Sat there during breakfast and they said, Lyndon, do you have any final word as we do this final presentation? I said, yes, I do. It comes from the Lord. Here, Jeremiah 29, 11 to 13. And they're like, this guy's crazy. And my wife was there and goes, you have to get used to it, you know. At the end of the day, when Lyndon is really nervous, he goes back to the boss to take care of the business. During that presentation, it's probably one of my lousiest presentation. I could not present or convince the client to save my life. I tried and tried. I could tell from my managing director to some of my associates, they look at me in face in the eye and they keep saying, Lyndon, do something. This was 3.5 years ago. Do something. You could be better than this. I try, but all was futility. And my potential client, 2 Austrian brothers with a bunch of consultant came to me. And the 2 Austrian brothers said to me, Lyndon, thank you very much. You've worked very hard. You've done a lot of work the last 6 months. But I don't think we're going to give the project to you. And let me tell you why. There are 3 things. 1, you guys are too young. Well, the final 2, the one we're competing, the practice, she was in her 70s, and she had a 150-man firm, extremely famous architect designer. 2, it'll be very expensive to fly you guys from Shanghai to London, 3-year project. And we have to constantly fly you back and forth, 30 trips, plus all your staff. It's an expensive proposition. These guys are based in London. And the 3, your design, quite frankly, is just not as good. As an architect, that was like, whoa, okay, not as experienced. You know, more expensive. I could find good reason, right? Saying not as experienced, but we're the hottest thing. Okay, or not as, more expensive because we're better. You can find the rationale, but your design is just flat out not as good. I was stunned. And I said, Jeremiah 29, 11 to 13, my plans for you is to prosper you, to give you a hope, Lord. I don't mind. Just give me a reason here to explain to the people underneath me, two of them do not believe in you. Give me the discernment and the wisdom to be able to tell them why we're not getting this project. That was noontime. They all had lunch. I went to my room and I just prayed. And I prayed and prayed and prayed. I said, Lord, thank you. I was just worshiping him because he's sovereign God. He's not going to change. He's an amazing God. So I said, Lord, I'm just going to praise you. I'm not going to ask you for things. I'm just going to thank you. 5 o'clock came. Rudolph, my client, called me and says, Lyndon, can I talk to you? I said, yes. We've made a decision to hire the other practice. We went lunch. All the consultant agreed. And let me repeat, you were not as experienced. You were more expensive. And your design was not as good. But after we made that decision at around 3 o'clock, this was his words. His English was not that good. But I believe this was coming from God. We did not have peace in our heart. We decided, me and my brother, against all the consultants' recommendation, we turned the decision and decide to give it to you and your practice. I shared this with you. I knelt down in Soho. If you've been to Soho in London, people were saying, are you okay, sir? I said, I'm fine. Who am I, Lord, that you are mindful of? Who am I that you are mindful of? The Lord then reminded me that in three years ago, the architectural world is going to lift you up. For those of you that follow the trend, that was exactly that year when a lot of our work starting to get published. The world's going to lift you up as the next avant-garde, the new face, not just in China, not just in Asia, but globally you're going to make a difference. But remember, you were not as experienced. You were more experienced. You were not as good, but I chose to give it to you. God is good. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived the things that God has prepared for those who loved him. And so we have to decide, are we going to be like Joshua? Are we going to credit them to other gods? Are we going to credit the gifts that God has given us to our talents to other gods? Or are we going to say, as for me and my family, we will serve the Lord? And I will say to this congregation, I don't know about you, but as for me and my family, I will serve this risen God. Thank you.